Scouts in the audience, so I think it would be appropriate for these young men to come forward and lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
Everyone please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Why don't you speak into the microphone and tell us who you are and what badges you're working on and...
My name is Thomas. I'm a Life Scout from Troop 101. I'm looking to get my citizenship in the community merit badge because it's my last merit badge to get my Eagle Scout. I'm here to listen to issues in our community and see how young people can help out.
Now, are you a Darien resident?
I am.
Good. Welcome.
Thank you.
Okay. And?
My name is Brian Rutkowski. I'm also a Boy Scout in Troop 101. I'm here to get my citizenship in the community badge and learn what it takes to be a good citizenship in my community and see what local government is like.
Good. Well, I think you came to a good meeting. Thank you. Thank you for coming. The roll, please.
Belke.
Here.
Belzac.
Here.
Klistic. Kenny.
Here.
Marquez.
Here.
MacIver.
Here.
Shower.
Here.
Six present.
We have a quorum. The next item on the agenda is questions, comments, and announcements of a general nature. I know that when I was speaking to some of the residents that are here this evening, you're here for the smart grid presentation. But at this point, is there anyone else in the audience that wanted to address the City Council on any other item? I think the residents who are here regarding the smart grid would probably want to wait until ComEd makes their presentation, and then you could ask questions then. Do you agree? That would be a better time? Okay. And is there anyone in the audience that wanted to address the City Council now on any other item? Doesn't have to be on the agenda this evening. Okay, then let's move on to the approval of the minutes of October 27th. Let's do them together.
No, because
you have to do them different?
Right, because we have different people absent.
Okay. Okay. The first item on approval of minutes is the October 27th, 2015 goal setting session. Do I have a motion to approve? Alderman Kenny, seconded by Alderman Belzec. Any questions on those minutes? Then the roll, please.
Kenny?
Aye.
Belzac?
Aye.
Belke?
Aye.
Shower?
Aye.
MacIver?
Abstain.
Marquez?
Aye.
Klistic is absent. So the abstention goes with the ayes, so we have 6-1 then.
Okay, those minutes have been approved. I'd like to have a motion to approve the November 2nd, 2015 City Council minutes. Alderman Shower, seconded by Alderman Belzec. Any additions or deletions for the clerk on these? Then the roll, please.
Shower?
Aye.
Belzac?
Aye.
Belke?
Abstain.
Kenny?
Aye.
Marquez?
Abstain.
MacIver?
Abstain.
We have 6-1.
And
three abstentions.
Yes, and those minutes have been approved. I think someone in the audience was wondering why so many people abstained. They weren't at the meeting. That's why they chose to abstain. So just an explanation. Let's move to receiving of communications. Do any of the aldermen have communications to share? I received a letter from a resident. I wasn't able to read his signature, but I will be reaching out to him personally to let him know. He took me to task and the city to task for not advertising or getting out the word about, I guess there was a home burglary on Concord Lane in Hinswood, and I wanted Tim to be aware that Hinswood is not in the city of Darien, and that's why we didn't take any action, did not make any announcements in that. As you know, we have been very right on top of any kind of situation like that happens in the city of Darien. So in this case, this in-home burglary was not even in the city of Darien. That's why we didn't make an issue out of it. If there's no other, yes.
I do, Madam Mayor, I apologize. I do have a communication. Mr. Ben Santori was contacted me, Mr. Gombach, regarding street sweeping that's supposed to be taking place. Would you like to take a moment on that, Mr. Dunbeck?
The street sweeping began last week, and it'll continue through this week, especially with the leaves. This is pretty much our last street sweeping, excuse me. Mr. Santori is on Adams, and it's a section that's partially in Darien, and there's other homes that are out of Darien, so we wanted to make sure that we did not forget them.
I think that's all I have.
Good idea. Yeah.
Madam Mayor?
Yes.
I had a follow-up to that. I did actually get a couple of emails, which I forwarded to you, regarding the windstorm we had last week. And they were down, you know, people had downed branches or large limbs, and they weren't sure if the city was going to go around to do a post-storm collection of branches.
Right. And while I was on vacation, Administrator Vanna and Mr. Salvato came to the conclusion that they took down the names of the residents that had branches down, and those residents were addressed with the branches being picked up by the Public Works. We have a couple more out there.
Okay.
So if residents had any concerns with the branches that came down, we are picking them up on a case-by-case basis.
Okay, so if there are residents that have something, they should call the city?
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Yeah, it wasn't citywide. The damage wasn't citywide. Yeah. That's why we didn't do a citywide sweep.
Correct.
Okay. Okay, there's one item that I wanted to, Dan, I think I'd like you to address the issue of our two Public Works employees and the
sure.
heroic efforts they made. I'd like to have them honored before we get into the rest of the mayor's report.
This is really a great opportunity for me to be able to speak about something else besides community development and or public works. While it is public works related, what they were doing and what they did do went above and beyond. So basically, about a week ago, the public works crews, Jeremy and Dave, we're out doing some operations on storm sewer maintenance when they had identified a house on 70th Street that had smoke coming out of it. At first, they thought it was leaves. As they looked a little bit harder, they noticed there were some flames and smoke coming out of the soffit. They did call the fire department. As they called the fire department, they went to the home, started knocking on the door, and see if anybody was home. By that time, correct me if I'm wrong, guys, the fire department was en route already, and the police came, and they were able to rescue a puppy. So long story short is, you know, it's just amazing how our team has the ambition, the vigilance to be not just doing their jobs in, you know, a mundane job at times, but to be able to see things and to be able to respond to it. Gentlemen, thank you very much.
Okay. Paul, do you have a camera?
Yeah.
Okay, Dan, I think it would be appropriate if you took a picture with Jeremy, the guys. And come on up. Would you come up here and take a picture in front of the dais? I warned the guys that they're going to go on the wall. Yeah, they're going to go on the wall of fame here.
Lost my nub.
You guys still have to be at work. It's tomorrow morning. So.
No, it's as Dan pointed out. It's not public works in their normal duties. Do not shirk their duties. If they see something out there that needs to be handled, they jump right in, and we're very proud of them and what they did. And I asked the guys how bad the house was damaged, and you said it wasn't too badly damaged because of your efforts to get to the house quickly. Very good. Okay.
And they're free to leave.
And you don't have to stick around, guys, if you don't want to.
Come on, guys, make me proud, all right?
Nice meeting you, Shauna. Let's move to the mayor's report, and the first item under my mayor's report is to appoint a temporary Police Chief. And Greg, would you please come up and be sworn in? As many of you know, our Chief Brown accepted a position as the Director of Homeland Security in Cook County, and so we're going to be looking for a new chief. But in the meantime, Greg Thomas has graciously volunteered to come in and be our interim. So please
raise your right hand and repeat after me. I state your name.
I, Greg Thomas.
Do solemnly swear.
Do solemnly swear.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And the Constitution of the State of Illinois.
And the Constitution of the State of Illinois.
And that I will faithfully discharge the duties.
And I will faithfully discharge my duties.
Of Police Chief.
Of Police Chief.
According to the best of my ability.
According to the best of my ability.
Congratulations. After you shake everybody's hands, I'd like to have you say a few words.
Sure.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks again.
Yes. Yes, please.
I appreciate the opportunity to come to Darien. Last Friday, I was working in the city of Aurora as their police chief and retired at 4 o'clock on Friday, and then back in the office this morning at 9. We're here in Darien. You know, there's a lot of comments about the size of Aurora, 200,000 versus the size of Darien, and a lot of people I spoke to today, it's all scalable. So there, things that happen in Aurora can happen here, do happen here. We take care of business very well in Aurora, and we take care of business very well here. I had 33 years as a sworn officer in Aurora, another 3.5 years as a cadet. So I was there almost 37 total years with the city of Aurora. I started as a cadet, worked my way through all the different ranks up to police chief. I worked all the different divisions, whether it was in investigations or administration or in patrol services. I worked a number of specialty jobs, including field training officer, employee review board is an organization that reports to the chief on discipline. I worked investigative deadly force team, so I did the investigations when an officer was involved in a shooting. I did special response team, which is our version of the SWAT team. I did that for about 17 years. I have a bachelor's degree in criminal justice and a master's degree in business administration. I'm married for 31 years and three children, 26, 24, and 19. And in a nutshell, that's me. So I'm glad to be here.
Thanks, Greg. I should call you Chief now. Thank you, Chief.
I always say my mom gave me the name Greg 55 years ago and just got Chief tonight, so Greg is fine for me.
Thank you. Okay, the next item under the mayor's report is ComEd. Terry, did you want to do the introductions?
Good evening. My name is Terry Simmons. I'm the External Affairs Manager for ComEd, and I want to thank the mayor and the council for having us out today so that we can talk about our smart meter deployment, which will start in the middle of this year, 2016, around July. So I want to introduce our Vice President of Automatic Metering Implementation, Mike McMahon, and he will present on the smart meters. Mike.
Good evening. Thanks for having us here. We're, in terms of our deployment, we're about...
Do you want to bring the microphone closer? There you go.
In terms of our deployment, we're about 1.8 million meters already installed in our ComEd service territory. It's 11,500 square miles, runs all the way from Lake Michigan out to the Mississippi. It covers mostly northern Illinois. We got about 1.8 million installed right now. Darien's coming up here in May. And one of the things we learned from the national deployments is it's important to educate the customers, your residents on the smart meters before we get here. So we're trying to get out to each of the municipalities before we get there, let you know we're coming, answer any questions you may have, We're willing to go to any sort of forums you'd like, because this is not a build it and they will come. It is a change, and so we'd like to be able to educate people as much as possible. When we, I'll hand you a map here, if I can just hand it around, of where we're going to install and when. Who can I hand this to?
I'll just pass it down.
This is basically our deployment plan for Darien that you'll see coming around. We have 10,306 meters in Darien right now. We're going to start July with the deployment of 3,800, August with 3,448, September with 22, and then finish it off in October for 2,391. We'll probably have a few commercial industrial meters left over. Those are the more complex types of meters. But basically, we want to come in, finish Darien, and then move out. Your meters will be installed by ComEd employees out of our Crestwood Cross Dock. So everybody that you see should be, plan right now is to be ComEd employees. That gets important in just a second, and I'll cover some of those points. In terms of notifications to the customers, we like to send a bill insert, which people haven't got this yet. The bill insert target is for May, so we'll send you a bill insert. Then we'll send you a postcard. The bill insert comes about 90 days in advance. Postcard comes 60 days in advance. You get a letter from myself about 30 days in advance saying we're going to be in your neighborhood in the next 30 to 45 days installing smart meters. Please leave your gates open, your dogs in, if you'd like to call and schedule an appointment. The day of, the installer will approach the resident's door, or if it's a multi-tenant building and we have access, we'll have people knocking on the individual doors. He'll let the resident know why we're there, what we're doing, and answer any questions they may have. If nobody's home, he'll go ahead and proceed with the installation of the meter, and then they leave a door card afterwards. Leave a door card afterwards giving you some of the benefits of smart meters and what you can do to take advantage of those. Then afterwards, 30 days afterwards, you get yet another mailing saying congratulations, you have a smart meter, has your account number on it, and says this is how you take advantage of the smart meters, sign up online for the various programs. I'll talk a little bit about those. And then finally, 60 days after that, you get yet one more mailing saying, congratulations, you got a smart meter. We just want to remind you, please sign up to take advantage of all the benefits of the smart meter. These are all the notifications we're making. We don't want anybody to be surprised. Our notification process has been very effective so far. Most people don't remember the bill insert. Most people do remember the letter, and that's probably the best communication. And then I should mention 10 days, so after you get the letter, and 10 days before deployment, you get a robocall that says, we'll be in your neighborhood within the next 10 days installing a smart meter. Please leave your gates open and your dogs inside. All the vehicles will be ComEd logoed. They're all ComEd logoed. They say smart meter installer on the side. All the employees will be ComEd. They all carry a badge, a field badge that identifies them as ComEd. There's a couple things we encourage residents to do, and one is always to ask for the badge. If you have somebody at your door representing themselves as ComEd and they cannot produce the badge, close the door, call the police, it is not us. This is an analog meter. This is what you have right now. You can't buy these anymore. These are not made anymore. They're refurbished. If we do have one, it's because we've taken it off of another resident. We've sent it out to a rehab facility and gotten it back. These are basically retreads these days. Serve their purpose. We have some out there that have been working fine for 30 years, but you know, how long can one go? This is a smart meter. This is what goes on the side of most of the residents' house. I'm going to draw your attention when I hand this around to the UL certification. We're particularly proud of that. We're the only utility in the country that requires all its meters to be UL certified. We've done that with our Northbrook partners right up there, and everything that comes out of our shop has that stamp on it. The one thing we will never do, so if you have, and we caution you, so is the police chief still here? We will never ask for money. There are scams out there. We do get them occasionally. Nobody from ComEd will ever ask for money. So if there's anybody at the door representing themselves as ComEd asking for money, please close the door, call the police, it's not us. Everything goes into the rates. Everything goes into the rate base. So we're never going to ask anybody for cash. This becomes particularly important in that one of the lessons we learned from our pilot is that the meter is new. The meter that goes on the side of the house is brand new. But the socket, which is owned by the customer, is oftentimes the age of the structure, and that can be quite old. We have now trained, or we did have some incidents in our pilot where we had three small fires. I don't want to play with words, we call them fires, but if you look at the pictures, it's smoke damage, no structures actually caught on fire. We had three small fires, and from that, we sent that out for forensic analysis, and all of it came back to say it was wiring associated with a particular kind of socket. We have trained all our installers to inspect the socket before we install the smart meter. If there's any degraded conditions inside of the socket, we have licensed union electricians on standby who will come out and make those repairs. We've done over 10,000 repairs this year alone, 15,000 total across it. So we pull the trigger on this quite often. To date, it's been very successful. In addition, we monitor the temperature of those meters six times a day. They have a, we were leading edge on this data analytics piece of it. And then if we do sense any atypical conditions, we dispatch one of our trouble men out to investigate those cases. But once again, we will never ask for any money. I will pause there for questions.
Alderman MacGyver?
Yeah.
Thank you. How long of an outage will residents experience? Because some may have,
sure,
you know, reasons that, you know, they can't have, you know, no power for a period of time.
Sure. Most of the time we've found we're able to jumper the socket. So the sockets come with what's called horns. We're able to jumper it, and the customer doesn't experience any outage. If they do, they experience one of somewhere between 1 and 3 minutes. That's probably generous. It's literally long enough to pull the old meter out, get the new meter, push the new meter in. So it's very, very short. And we do caution people in both a written material and the day of the door knock that they may experience a brief outage. But we've been pretty good. Most people do not experience an outage.
So if somebody has a problem with the sockets, as you were describing earlier,
right,
then they might experience a longer outage.
Well, it depends on what happens. If the condition is such that the installer identifies it before it even touches things, which that does happen, particularly with what we call the underground services. So if you get an overhead service, you know, the wire comes in from atop your house and then comes down. There's underground services also, and then those have what we call the raceways that go on the side of the house. Sometimes we identify a potential issue there just by visual inspection. We don't touch anything. We call the electrician to come out, notify the customer. But there are cases where we will go, the inspection is fine. There's absolutely nothing that's atypical from the inspection standpoint. The installer will grab the meter, pull it out, and the socket comes with it. In that case, that's an emergent condition for us, and we have an electrician come right over. But to your point, that customer could experience an outage of several hours, depending on what the repair requires. Now, on the one hand, you say, well, isn't that awful? They got an outage. On the other hand, that's a failure waiting to happen. It's just sitting there, and it hasn't been identified. So actually, we feel pretty good about being able to identify those conditions and remediate them, once again, at no direct cost to the customer.
Alderman MacGyver?
It'll be me, sorry. I think when it comes to electric service, besides obviously the cost,
right.
I think the number one priority for residents is reliability.
Right.
With the smart meter, will they, you know, say there's an outage and a resident isn't home, will the smart meter report the outage then to ComEd? Will you be aware of things that even the resident may not be aware of, and so potentially reducing the downtime,
right,
because that information's flowing in already?
Right. We're getting there. We're already getting there.
Okay.
So the smart meters are were authorized by the Illinois state legislature in 2011, October 2011, under what's called the Energy Infrastructure Modernization Act. So we're modernizing the entire grid. And the meters that are out there right now are obsolete. There's over 50 million smart meters installed nationwide right now. So we're not like a first innovator on this. We're a second follower on this. And as part of that, it's $2.6 billion. It was authorized by the Illinois State Legislature to upgrade the grid. And you've seen a lot of work going on right now in the neighborhoods. So we're upgrading the meters. We're upgrading the grid itself with distribution automation devices. You might say, what makes a smart meter smart? Has a small computer chip in it that stores interval usage, and it has two small radios. One radio communicates with us. One radio communicates with the customer if they enable it. Now, the radio that communicates with us operates less than 5 minutes a day, total on time, less than 5 minutes a day. Most of the folks will say less than three. I keep it at five. Less than 5 minutes a day. There's myths out there that it operates continuously. It does not. It transmits its information back to us six times a day. Part of that, it's a wireless device, and it communicates over our network. If you drive down your streets right now and look at your utility poles, we don't like to call them telephone poles, utility poles, you'll see, if you see a white antenna on one top of those poles, that's our network. So your network is being built out right now, pretty close to being complete. But you also have distribution automation devices on your system, which is already out in town right now, and so you'll see those antennas. Now, part of that network design allows us to interrogate the meter to see if it's on or off, and it also sends us a signal to tell it it's off. It's called a last gasp. So anytime a meter loses power for any reason, it sends us a signal saying, I have lost power. Now, that can be particularly important for theft detection, and there's a lot of theft on our system, which gets, everybody pays for that, I pay for that, you pay for that. To the extent we can reduce theft, you know, that keeps everybody's bills down. It will tell us maybe you do have an outage, and particularly on a blue sky day, we can go out and repair that right away, and we're doing that now. We get those signals, and we're able to do that now. During a large storm, you're able to do what's called ping the meter. So I can send a signal to the meter, and I can say, are you on or are you off? And if it says it's off, we know it's a real outage. Now, with the old meters, and I'm an emergency response director, I've done this myself, we still do it in the areas where people don't have the smart meters. Towards the end of the storm, you literally drive around and look for the lights on the porches. Oh, they got their lights on, they must be okay. Well, we don't have to do that now. We can, if you have a smart meter, I can ping and I can tell whether you're on or whether you're off. This year alone, we've saved 13,000 truck rolls. 13,000 truck rolls. That means those 13,000 trucks went to somebody that really did have their power off, instead of somebody that didn't have their power off. Now, in terms of the automatic outage notification, that functionality comes in 2016, the last half of 2016. We've been stepping it in as we were able to go in. The problem is, if any guys are software people, the meter always sends us the signal. We get the signal. But I have to take that from the meter network system, and I have to integrate that signal in with what we call our outage management system, which is like, you know, Microsoft talking to Apple. and so you have to build the bridge. We're going to have that bridge built the last half of this year, and then we'll have automatic outage notification. We still encourage people to call in, but we're going to make a lot of progress in this in the last half of the year. We'll be there.
You said something about people can talk to their meters, communicate with their meters.
If they choose.
How do they do that?
Well, you can buy an in-home device. It's called an in-home device. And they can be quite inexpensive, and they can range up to a little over $100. And on our website, we have devices that have been proven compatible with our system. You can buy that device, then we'll help you enable the second radio in that meter, and then it communicates directly with that in-home device. That gives you real-time information on how much electricity you're using. Right now, with the smart meter, everybody will be able to go on the web the day after and view their energy usage from the previous day in half-an-hour increments, which can actually be quite revealing. But if you have an in-home device, you can actually see what you're using right then. And I've seen a customer with an in-home device, and he was showing me the in-home device, which the kids had instantaneously figured out. But he showed this to me. His wife was in the kitchen, and he said, "Now watch this." He said, "Honey, turn on the toaster oven." And it's like a speedometer, so it's not complicated. But turned on the toaster oven, dial goes up. Said, "Now watch this," and he went over and turned on the air conditioning. It went way like this. So I know a person. That has an in-home device, and we all know that your house draws electricity even if you have everything turned off. It's that clock on the microwave. It's that little blinking light on the computer. You're drawing electricity whether you've got every switch in the house turned off or not. It's called vampire load. So I know a person. And she figured out what her vampire load was. And then every day before she went to work, she went around the house, she checked her load, and if it was higher than her vampire load, she went out and figured out what she left on. She reduced her electric bill by 30%. So the meters themselves do not reduce your electricity usage at all. They're just a pass-through device. Whatever you use goes through, and it measures it. But it enables a lot of different things you can do to reduce your energy usage. One of the big ones we encourage everybody to sign up for is called peak time savings. You can't lose on peak time savings. You have to have a smart meter to have it. With peak time savings, the electricity rates are set on the 4 or 5 hottest days of the year. That's what sets your rates, supply and demand, right? So that to the extent you can bring down those hottest days of the year, everybody's rates come down. And it doesn't take that many people playing. As studies say, 6 to 8%. So on the hottest days of the year, if you sign up for peak time savings, about 4 different events, we'll give you a notification that today's a peak time savings day. And then you go around, and if you reduce your usage below what we would calculate you would otherwise use, you get a credit on your bill. $1 per kilowatt hour. If you don't do anything, you choose not to play, no harm, no foul, you're just going to pay what you would otherwise. We've got about 60,000 people signed up for this program right now. The average savings is about $3 an event, but we have had people save up to $33 an event. Now, they turn their whole house off. I'm not recommending that, but you can, and we know who they are. In fact, we just had some prizes we awarded for our first round. But you can save up to 33, and this particular lady I was just talking to last week saved $22 on a single event. Can't lose on peak time savings. Everybody should be signing up for it.
So to check your, if you want to check your usage, you would go online. You'd have to have an account with ComEd. Do you have to set up an online account?
Well, it's not so much an account as it is a login, because you already have the account. That's why we send you the postcard within 30 days after with your account number on it. Some of our customers said, "You know, I don't want to go look at my account. Can't you just tell me what it is?" So we said, "Okay." We put it on the postcard. You then develop a login with a username and a password. That gives you a portal into the ComEd website. You're able to see your electricity usage. The day before, you're able to check your energy efficiency compared to your neighbors, and you can sign up for real-time rates, or what we call now hourly, residential hourly usage. So just about everybody is on a flat rate. Probably everybody here is on. You pay the same amount for electricity day or night. However, that electricity prices actually fluctuate throughout the day and the evening. And in fact, between about 3 and 5 o'clock in the morning, they can go negative. We'll actually pay you to use electricity. Now, like I say, it's 3 a.m., but if you have an electric vehicle and you're charging it between 10 and 5, you're gonna be a winner on this. And so smart meters also enable this hourly usage, dynamic pricing schemes that in many parts of the country that are further along than us have a lot of them. Texas has over 100 plants. In Texas, you go down there, they have free electricity on weekends. And we encourage the development of alternate rate plans that is enabled by the smart meter. Now, I'm on it. Since I signed up for it, I've saved $100.
Alderman Kenny?
Ms. McGann, what kind of security measures do you have? We've just experienced what's going on here in Paris.
Sure.
And I see those kinds of things. It's computerized, it's hacking, it's
sure.
What kind of measures is ComEd taken to? I mean, I'm going to say limited, because you'll never totally stop something.
That's right.
But we
That's
need
right.
to make sure we're limited. What's your plan?
Yeah, well, you know, we have, this goes to a broader question of, we've got about 1.8 million meters out there right now. We do have some people that refuse the smart meter. They say they don't want it, and that's fine for the time being. The Illinois State Legislature allowed that temporarily. There's three major reasons that people refuse the smart meter. One is data security, one is data privacy, and then the other is perceived health effects. So on the data security standpoint, what we've done is, when we designed our meters, I don't know much, but I know I need more memory tomorrow than I need today. There is a small computer chip on it. So we built extra memory into our meters. That firmware is able to be updated wirelessly over our network. We employ the latest state-of-the-art cryptographic techniques. We also hire people to hack into our system. We hire people to hack us. And if they do find any vulnerabilities, we close those right away. So nobody's going to tell you you're hack-proof. If they do, they're, you know, nobody should be saying that. I'm not saying that. But we do everything we can. We update our software. We have people try to break into our system. We close those vulnerabilities. And we can constantly update our security measures over the web. Now, even if somebody did hack into a smart meter, the only thing they're going to get is a serial number and kilowatt hour usage. There's no personal information in that data flow at all. All that stuff gets synced up back in the back office, back in the back servers. But if they hack into a meter, they'll get the meter serial number, and they'll get kilowatt hour usage, and that's it.
There's no possible way of somebody hacking into to my meter, right, a personal meter, and somehow able to add money to my bill and take money off of theirs. There's no possible way with anything like that, correct?
Well, once again, I'm not going to say no possible way in this day and age, but haven't seen it and don't know how it could be done.
1.8 million meters installed.
It's much more likely that somebody will go physically steal your meter.
Okay.
And we have seen that.
1.8 million meters installed. What's a fail rate? Are they all, I mean, I'm sure there's got to be some deficiency at that point.
I haven't seen it.
Thank
low
you.
Enough that I can't count it, and if you talk to my guys, I count almost everything. So,
Alderman, did you have another question?
Yeah, it was security related as well.
Sure.
You know, I'm looking at it from a different perspective. It's the ability. Is it? You know, I guess is there a possibility? Are we more vulnerable now that it's sort of technology based that someone could actually, you know, shut down power on the grid? You know, shut down entire areas through this.
Well, that would be, that's one of our security measures. So in you can only affect so many, I'm not gonna tell you how many, you can only affect so many meters of one kind, because the risk is not at the distribution level, you know, which is where all these meters are. That's where you are. The risk is that any sort of failures cascade back into the transmission system. And we have measures in it that make that nearly impossible to do. I won't say impossible, but that's our goal, is that's impossible to do. That can't be done. Now, but along those lines, I want to comment on the data privacy. That's probably the easiest one to deal with. So some folks think, well, you're going to take all that. We record the data on half an hour intervals. Some people think you're going to take that data and sell it to third parties. And I will tell you, there are third parties out there that want it. I don't know why they want it, but, you know, there's entities out there that want that data. That's probably the easiest one for us to tackle, because the answer to that is simple: we will not. The only way we're going to give that interval data to a third party is if the customer authorizes it expressly. And I'm not going to ask them. They have to, you know, call up and say, I want to give my data to the people. We've got some tools that we're putting in place to allow people to do that if they want to, but they have to take the action. So, or if it's required by law, if we're approached by a law enforcement agency saying cough it up and it's a legal request, we're going to do that. And then the third one is anonymous. So we do aggregate the data. We will strip out the name, the addresses, all the personal identifiable information, and we'll provide that in groups of no less than 25 to people who ask for it. Universities, other utility providers need this to help develop their dynamic rate structures. For instance, are you guys on municipal ag?
Yes, we are.
Are you on municipal aggregation? So I'm not sure when your contract comes up, but right now, dynamic rates, none of the muni ag providers, what we call the RESs, maybe one or two out there, but have dynamic rates, and we're encouraging those folks to provide that. You also have to be a little careful in terms of this data privacy, that when you renew your contract or when your contract comes up, that in that contract there's not a permission to share that information if you don't want to do it. So that's my only caution on that. But we're working hard to give these RESs the information they need so they can develop dynamic rates as well. The real-time rates are the hourly residential usage rates I talked about. The only way you get that is through ComEd as a supplier.
You said something earlier about that residents can refuse temporarily.
They can.
Why do you use the word temporarily?
Well, the legislative law, the law under the Energy Infrastructure Modernization Act, says that folks can delay the installation of the smart meter, but they cannot permanently refuse it. That's in the law. Now remember, this is our standard. We're moving away from, as I said, you can't buy those analog meters anymore. You buy them as refurbished meters, so you can't buy those anymore. So this is our new standard, and the law was pretty clear that said you can delay taking a smart meter, but you can't permanently opt out. Now, if you do choose to delay the meter, and we have a very low refusal rate. I think I said before, we have 1,700 people that are refused the meter for one of those three reasons I talked about. The second biggest one is other. 1,700, that's a 0.10% refusal rate. And if somebody wants to refuse the meter, that's their right. They don't need to give us any information. They don't need to give us a reason. We're going to ask. We're going to reach out to those folks. We're going to try to educate them. It's just not an okay. They might even think we're bugging them a little bit. But we want to educate people on the benefits of the meters and the facts, because there's a lot of poor information out there. Then they'll receive two letters over a four-month period, and this is all part of the tariff. At the end of the 4 months, if they still refuse the meter, there'll be an additional charge placed on their bill of $21.53 a month. You might say, well, why? Why do I get that charge? Because one of the big cost savings of the smart meters is I don't have to go out and read meters anymore. That's all electronically transmitted to me. So if you refuse the meter and you keep an analog meter, I'm obligated to come out and read your meter. That means that I have to keep a meter reader on property to do nothing but come out and read your meter. So the notion is the cost causer pays the cost. Should, if Mike refuses to have the smart meter, should you all pay to keep the meter reader on property, come read my meter? And the answer out of the legislature was no. If the person wants to refuse the meter, they can, but they should bear the cost. So the $21.53 is meant to cover the cost of the meter reader. It does not. It's about half of it, actually. And we report on this, but that's what the cost is for. And we're not interested in the money. We don't want the money. We want to install the meter.
So you're saying that residents could technically not have a smart meter ever, but have to pay the $21 a month?
Not ever. The law is clear that it says everyone in the state of Illinois, because Ameren is part of this as well, but everyone in our service territory for ComEd will have a smart meter within 1 year of the end of full deployment. And right now, the end of full deployment is 2019.
Okay.
That's about what where we're counting it.
Can any jurisdiction refuse to be involved in, a city in the state of Illinois refuse to be involved in the smart meter program?
The refusals have to come from the individual customer. As I said, this is state law.
Alderman Kenny?
Environmental concerns. I know I've heard some, rumblings about, radiation, giving off with these meters. Could you elaborate on that?
Yeah. Well, environmental concerns is a little bit different than the radio frequency. So I'll just address both of those. The meters, you'll often hear that smart meters enable renewables. And the reason for that is because if you can adopt hourly usage or real-time rates, then renewables, primarily wind, which is what Illinois has most of, blows during the night. So, and it also comes enabled for net metering. So if you choose to put on rooftop solar, that smart meter is sitting there to allow you to do what's called net metering, send your excess out to the grid, get a credit for it, and then when you need it, take it in the other way. So it supports net metering and supports renewables. Those 13,000 truck rolls I talked about not having to do, that all gets translated into carbon emission reductions. So smart meters are environmentally friendly in that sense. In terms of the health effects of the meters, there are folks out there, and they believe that it is a wireless device. It operates about 900 megahertz. That's the same frequency as a garage door opener or baby monitor. Operates less than 5 minutes a day, but they believe that it does emit radio waves, and they believe that causes cancer. There's been hundreds of studies on this. I can provide you with some of the credible ones. There's a lot of bad information out there, but we go with peer-reviewed scientific literature. There's hundreds of studies of this, so their conclusions are all the same. Insufficient evidence to cause any change in the standards. We're regulated by the Federal Communications Commission. It's right on the meter, and we operate at well below what the FCC requirements are. Typical 5% of FCC regulations. Either the meter gets stuck on, and we haven't had that occur, it's 40%. That's where the RF concerns come from.
So you have not, the 1.8 million meters you've installed, so none of the meters around there have experienced any loss of grass, pets, along those lines?
No, none. Remember that these are radio waves, so... I don't want to get into too much radiation talk, but, when you go to the dentist, those are gamma rays. These are radio waves. So radio waves, by their very nature, are much less powerful than any kind of radiation that you're out there. And there's three things that reduces exposure to any kind of radiation: time, distance, and shielding. So if you... can minimize your exposure. These things are on less than 5 minutes a day. You're going to receive less dose than you would otherwise. If you have shielding, that cuts down on the dose. And most of these are on the outside of homes. So you have a wall between you. And I don't know anybody that spends their day standing next to a meter. So you got a wall, and then how far away you are. So the as you double the distance, the dose goes down by the square of that, four times. So if you double the distance, the dose goes down by four times. So the exposure you get from a smart meter is less than you get from most household appliances. I mean, you know, the people that are really concerned about this, and some don't, but the first thing you do is throw this away. Because this is going to give you about 100, 150 times the exposure of any smart meter. I don't know anybody that walks around with a smart meter next to their head for 30 minutes at a time. Microwaves emit RF as well, or they actually it's microwaves. Your router in your house emits the same kind of radio waves. So, you know, these are much less exposure than what we see day to day. And as I said, there's lots and lots of studies out there. I'd be glad to share one with you. We brought a copy with us tonight if you'd like.
And is there any other Alderman? Yeah, Alderman Belge?
Yes, ma'am.
Question with, if you don't sign up online and get an account logged in, will the communication from ComEd to the residents stop? Will there still be letters or energy usage reports that are sent to the homes for the people that don't sign
up
online?
Well, yeah, you get those little letters about your efficient neighbors.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
yep.
Everybody gets those. Do you like them?
I don't use them, but I know people that do.
Yeah. No, those don't stop. Those are all part of our energy efficiency program.
But they would they stop for the people that went online?
No.
Okay.
No.
Because that seems to be a waste, you know, from if you can give that information to them online.
That's a good point. That's a good point. Yep.
Any other questions from the council? If you don't mind, I'll open it up to the audience. If you would just step back, and if there's anyone in the audience that wanted to address, come up to the microphone and ask a question, and I know Mike will be glad to answer those questions for you. I think Terry said he's going to be just, yes?
I had a quick question for a gentleman.
Okay.
I'm sorry, I can wait, whatever.
You wait,
know.
Okay, go ahead. She was on her way up here, so, okay. Okay.
Good evening, Mayor Weaver. Good evening, Council Board.
Yes.
Administrators, Darien residents, and guests who are here.
Can you tell us who you are?
I'm Judith LaRose. I am a resident of Darien.
Okay, Judith LaRose. Okay.
I was notified by mistake on September 14th about the implementation. They told me, the gentleman's name who was an associate of Commonwealth Edison, his name was Brian, they said within 10 days you will have a smart meter implemented into your home or on your home. I was perplexed because that is not what I understood happened with smart meters. Subsequent to that, I have been contacted by no less than four more people from Commonwealth Edison because I submitted 10 questions to the Assistant City Administrator, Paul Nosek, who in turn submitted the questions to Ms. Simmons, who's here tonight.
Right.
My questions basically are 10 inclusively. The first one is, am I or are we legally required to accept a smart meter?
I think the answer to that is yes.
Well, unfortunately, we are not legally required to accept a smart meter. It's forcible implementation of the smart meter. It's imposed upon the citizen, not only in the state of Illinois, but in the country. And this is worldwide. This is part of Agenda 21 and Agenda 2030.
What are we talking about?
Smart meters.
No, what is Agenda 21?
The law.
Agenda 21 is an implementation that was signed in 1972 by George Herbert Walker Bush along with 128 other countries, basically to save energy across the world, but it is forcible implementation of not only smart meters, but water meters, gas meters. It also accompanies many other things.
Okay, so so your point is that this is forcible.
Yes,
okay,
it is.
Okay, all right, so you're making that point. Is there something else that you wanted to, because we've already learned that there is nothing we can do about this. This smart meter program is going to go forward. We haven't got the control to stop it in the city of Darien, and so I don't.
Pardon me, Mayor, are you aware that in 1996, the lobbying people that worked for the telecom companies wrote the telecom act that was basically implemented in 1996, Section 704. Basically restricting municipalities and states to have any compliance of the installation of smart meters, be they water, electric, or gas.
You know what? I think
is
you're...
Is this being challenged? Is this law being challenged is the question.
This has been for 20 years. The American citizen wasn't privy to it.
No, this new law.
Yeah,
this
this new energy law.
It was 1996.
Alderman Belke is asking, is it being challenged? Because at this point, there's nothing we can do about it.
I understand that, but it's basically something, it's information that people did not know at the time.
Okay.
That is why you don't have any restriction of having a smart meter implemented in the city of Darien.
Okay.
If I may. Can
well,
I?
Well, unfortunately, we have a 3-minute limit on presentations. I don't know if you've reached the 3-minute point, but I just want you to be aware that, you know, if you're bringing these facts to us, the bottom line is we can't do anything about it.
And this also goes against our Fourth Amendment rights. The right of the people against unlawful search and seizure of their persons, homes, papers, and effects without any reason shall not be violated. That's part of the Fourth Amendment. This is totally against the Fourth Amendment.
Yeah.
Can I make a comment that you said that you referred your 10 questions or concerns to Paul? Is that correct?
Yes.
Okay, so maybe we, you know, since it is sounds pretty lengthy, you know, staff can review that.
Yeah, I don't know if ComEd has responded yet, Paul or
Paul. Do you know if ComEd has responded to Ms. LaRose?
I believe they have.
Did you get a response back from ComEd?
I received several phone calls from ComEd, and I talked to Umberto Romo, I talked to Elizabeth Chang, health specialist. I talked to Umberto Romo, who was a supervisor in Northern Illinois. At least that's what he told me his title was. And I did talk to Ms. Simmons briefly.
Okay.
And
your questions were answered from Ms. Simmons?
Yes.
No, they weren't. I basically shared the same information with her as I'm sharing with you.
Okay. All righty. You have a very difficult task on your hands to fight this issue. I believe that's where you have to come from. You have to make this a grassroots effort because we certainly can't do it right here. Alderman MacIver?
I'm kind of curious, just...
Sylvia, the mic, I'm sorry, you're tilt, yeah.
Yeah, what is your, I guess, why are you opposed to having this technological upgrade to your service? I'm just curious.
There's no empirical or evidence or protocols that have been given to the American citizen showing that there is an infringement of privacy, safety, security. There is overbilling issues in Aurora and in Tinley Park. Tinley Park has hired a public relation firm basically because of the water meter fallout. They were miscalibrated in Tinley Park. People paid hundreds and thousands of dollars over and above what their water bills were supposed to be. I have the article from the Chicago Tribune basically stating that they have hired a public relations firm.
I think we all read that in the newspaper.
Okay.
Did you say Crestwood?
No, Tinley Park.
Tinley Park. I remember reading that in the newspaper. So is that your answer?
Yeah, I'm just kind of curious because I'm wondering are most of the residents here are opposed to it? Because what I guess I heard was at least until 2019, 2020,
mm-hmm.
You know, several years out, you can keep your meter.
But this is forcibly imposed.
Well,
this is by implied consent, and those
and I mean,
of us that are
things can happen between now and 2020, I guess, and the law could change. But I mean, it does sound like you have the ability to keep your existing meter if you so choose, at least through 2020, because they won't be done till then.
I was told by one of the people I spoke to, Umberto Romo, who was one of the first people I spoke to, that this is inevitable. You are going to have to comply, and that doesn't go along with what the law states in the Fourth Amendment.
Okay. As I said, you have a very big task to fight this issue, and as we all know, it always starts at a grassroots level.
Mm-hmm.
So, I'm sure you're up to the task of fighting this issue.
Okay.
Thank you for coming forward.
You're very welcome. Thank you.
Did anyone else want to address?
All right, Mayor. Excuse me. We'll send those questions out so the council has those anyway.
Yeah. Okay. Yes.
Comments there. Tenley Park did have an issue that was well published in the papers. Our meters are regulated by the Illinois Commerce Commission. We do what we call periodic exchanges on an annual basis, so that a certain amount of meters are taken out. They're checked for calibration. We report that to the ICC. In addition, when you have a smart meter, you can sign up for what's called a high energy usage alert. And if your energy usage is 10% higher than what it was the previous month and the previous year, you'll get an alert to do that. And you can call and say, what's going on with this? And we'll help you figure that out. The only other comment I'd like to make is the meters belong to ComEd. They're our property. So all we're trying to do is upgrade our property, upgrade our technology from what has been out there for 50 years to become a little closer to where the rest of the world is right now. So.
Did anyone else want to address the council? Please come up. You'll have to bring that microphone down.
Hi, my name is Stephanie Kovacek, and actually I'm a resident of Lamont, and I'm here because I know this is going to come into my town sooner or later.
Okay, we'll ask you to make it very brief since you aren't a Darien resident, okay?
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yes.
Less than three minutes?
Pardon me?
Less than 3 minutes.
Less than 3 minutes would be great.
Okay, somebody put on the clock. Here we go. Okay, then I'm going to ask all my questions at the same time. You can decide whether or not you want to discuss it. As far as an analog and not replacing it, everybody knows you can have anything made anywhere at any time. If they don't sell it, you can get someone to make it and sell it. And when it comes to ComEd, and you hear so much about the grid and how we're in trouble with the grid and how the grid is aging and that it can only be made overseas in Germany or someplace and we don't manufacture it here, as a point of interest, that we can't make it here in the United States. So my question is, why isn't ComEd more worried about that than they are installing new meters? And I know they want to install meters because they want to take away the jobs from the meter readers, and it's a savings from them. Also, I've been in Christine Redonio's office, and she's on the state level, and discussed the smart meters there. And someone who had an in-depth knowledge of it, and I don't know if you heard this or not, but you know, Naperville had been arguing against it for years, and we had people that really understood the issue on the opposite end of ComEd explain why, how dangerous it is and bad. And but anyway, the point about Christine Redonio being in her office, I know that Commonwealth Edison gave money to Christine Redonio. So why are they lobbying? Why are they lobbying our representatives or our government? You know, I'm making the point that they're in cahoots, okay? And let's see. I'd like to know what ComEd is going to do with the extra money now that all these meter readers will no longer be employed reading meters. Are they going to work on our infrastructure, or is the savings just going to go in their pocket? And I do realize that there's going to be a cost in purchasing new meters, but there'll be a time that cost, that they'll be able to jump over that cost and regain the income from putting up that cost. Thank you.
Yes, thank you for your comments.
There's a couple really good comments in there. First, our business case for the installation of smart meters, a lot of folks nationally got money, federal money. We got none. Our meter installation program rests solely on the value of its business case. That business case is on file with the Illinois Commerce Commission. It's Googleable. What it says is that over the life, 20-year life of a meter, we will return $2.2 billion in net savings to our customers. The break-even point, to your point, ma'am, is an excellent point, is about year nine, about year nine. That's when we recover all the costs and the money starts flowing back into costs. We file, as part of EIMA, we file rates every year, annually. That means that any savings we realize through reduction of meter readers, which I'll address that, or any other, these efficiencies, the 13,000 truck rolls, the ability to ping meters, the ability to return people to power faster in cases of a storm, is returned to the customers on an annual basis. We're a regulated utility. Our rate of return is regulated. Any savings we get does not get to be pocketed. It's returned to the customers. And in fact, the last rate case we filed was a rate reduction. It wasn't a rate increase. Now, regarding the employees, this is a great point. The employees we have about 523 meter readers. We've taken those meter readers, and they are now meter installers. They're installing our meters at, by the way, higher wages than they earned as a meter reader. And then we have a series of what we call line schools, where they can go to be an overhead line person or an underground worker. They can go into one of our management positions. And we've got our plan put in place that all these people will have an opportunity to do a different job before the end of this program. So our intent is we're going to feather these folks out. As you get further deployed, you need less installers and you need less readers. We're going to feather them out into the broader ComEd. That's our plan. And we've been very open with our employees on this. All our employees know this. Now, regarding the manufacturing of the grid, well, the grid, it's not the grid. It's a series of components. I mean, you can see them when you drive down the street. That aluminum wire you see over, Southland wire, was manufactured out of Southern Illinois. Our URD cable, that's manufactured out of Southwestern Illinois. All the distribution automation devices you see, they're split between G&W out of Bolingbrook, Illinois, and S&C Electric out of Northbrook, or the north part of Chicago, Illinois. Our meters are assembled. All our residential meters are being assembled right here in the state of Illinois, down in the old, right behind the baseball park. And we've got over 40 people working three shifts, 5 days a week right now, that did not have jobs before we started. So we lean heavily on our local sources for manufacturing. We draw a lot of places from the state of Illinois, and we're a big jobs creator. Part of the requirements of the Energy Infrastructure Modernization Act was that we did create 2,000 full-time equivalent jobs at the peak of the program. We have exceeded that by two times. So this is a powerful economic engine for the state of Illinois. For every job we create from our linemen, and these are good paying jobs. These aren't McDonald's jobs, no offense to McDonald's, but these are good paying jobs. It flows over and creates additional jobs. So, and those reports, that job creation report, is also submitted to the Illinois Commerce Commission on an annual basis as a matter of the public record.
Okay, thank you. Did anyone else want to address the City Council? And I would suggest also, if there's anyone in the audience that wanted to personally ask questions of, and Terry Simmons, I'm sorry, I always pronounce your name wrong, you can take those names and phone numbers so that you can personally communicate with these individuals. Okay, and we could actually have a sign-up sheet to take anybody's names and addresses who would like to. Get questions answered. Dan, you said you had something?
Yes, for a quick question for ComEd. In regards to the old meters, the analog meters, have you done a meter accuracy test, and what has that test results been?
For the analog meters?
Yeah.
Yeah, well, they're part of the same program for accuracy, but when we take the meter out, we read it, and we take a picture of the read, so that if there is a question on what the final meter reading was, we have a photographic record of what that was. But those analog meters go into the same program that the digital meters go on.
Right, I guess my question is, bench testing them after a meter is pulled out,
right,
for accuracy, are they running 70%, 90%?
It's a pretty low number, actually. It's regulated by the ICC, and it's about 50,000 a year we do on periodic exchanges, so the number is pretty low. But across the board, yeah, that's the way it's done.
But how is that meter reading? that analog meter.
Are they 95% accurate? Are they 97% accurate?
I don't know the exact number, but it's in that frame.
Because our water meters, you know, we can test those, and it could show if a meter's 97% accurate, and I think that's what Dan is
part of the reason I'm asking is, obviously, if they're running slower, the new meters will be more accurate, which will have a higher rate, but at the same time, within the future, whether it's a year or 2 years, those rates could be reduced because of the better efficiency.
No, that's right. And that we actually considered that as a risk when we started the program, because these old electromechanical meters can slow down over time. And so then you put in an accurate meter, and the kilowatt-hour usage goes up. We had a program in place to check the previous bill versus the current bill. We call it a high bill alert. And we discontinued it because it just never really occurred. That's how minimal that was, the minimus that the occasion was. California had a big problem with that. But in the middle of their implementation, they had one of the hottest summers on record, and they also put in place a rate increase. So then as people were getting smart meters, they were like, hey, what's going on? They had a big program to go check the accuracy, and some other states have too, and all these meters, all these smart meters have been proven to be highly accurate. There haven't been any issues at all. And we haven't had any issues between the old ones we pulled out and the new ones.
Okay. All right. Any other questions from anyone in the audience wanted to address? Please come on up. We have one more.
My name's June Muggenborg, and I live at Myers Commons. When I first moved in, I did not have the right meter attached to my, and a ComEd man knocked on my door and told me, if you ever get this number on your bill, you're going to have the right meter. I don't know who he was, but I kept calling five times in the year. And finally, five of us, you know, when it was built, we had different people's meters. And they told me mine was going to go up. It did not go up. It went down. You know, surprise, surprise. But if you know you have the right meter, you are careful with the electricity. Now, are these smart meters going to be smart enough to stay with the right person? The meters are all inside the building, and we do have a lot of zap in our small apartments. And, you know, I just pray that not too many people get sick from it. You know, we have people on oxygen and, you know.
Well, now, Jane, just so everyone knows, Jane lives in the Myers Senior Housing Facility on Plainfield Road, close to Lamont Road. And I'm wondering, Jane, if those meters, when you initially moved in, if those meters were not properly installed per each unit, and that's why that happened.
Somebody didn't do their job right.
Yeah, exactly. That probably happened during the installation for each one of the apartment units.
And they've been called back since because they found other ones got exceeded.
Well, I think you need to take Jane's information so that some ComEd can get back to her on that issue to be sure we've got it right for her. So thank you very much, Jane. Why don't we?
This is a real issue that she's bringing up. It's called mixed meters. You described it pretty accurately. It's where during installation, an installer puts a meter in 2A, and he puts another one in 2B, and it's supposed to be 2A and 2B. And what we've seen with our smart meters is they're actually helping us identify mixed meter situations. We're piloting a couple ways to do some testing to be able to verify that a little bit easier, and then we'll be able to correct it. But unfortunately, mixed meter situations do exist on the system. And if yours hasn't been, or if you don't think yours has been remediated or corrected, we'd be glad to look into that for you.
It's corrected now. Okay. That's a different situation.
Mixed meters. You're exactly accurate, man.
Okay. All righty. Did anyone else want to address the council? Well, I tell you what, Well, I'll have Paul go through the audience to see if anyone wants to give us their contact information that we can share with Terry. But otherwise, I thank you all for coming out. I hope the presentation was informative. And Terry, everyone with ComEd, thank you very much for coming out. We really appreciate the presentation. So you said starting early next year, we'll start to see all of the ComEd mailings and
May.
May, I think
should
it was.
Start seeing the bill inserts in about May.
Okay. Thank you. Okay.
And I think, obviously, with Paul, you can communicate with ComEd, but whatever information we could put out, we have been putting some out on Direct Connect and things, but we can continue that through the installation.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah, let's, Paul, I'll just leave it up to you to see if anyone wants to make a contact with us on that. We'll move on then. Claire Bongiovanni from the Chamber could not be with us this evening, so there'll be no Chamber, Darien Chamber report. Let's move to the City Clerk's report.
Just one announcement, Madam Mayor. City offices will be closed on Thursday and Friday, November 26th and 27th, in observance of Thanksgiving.
Okay. City Administrator's report?
No report.
Mike, would you, Mike, is his name?
Yes.
Mike, would you mind waiting out in the lobby? I'm sure when some of these residents leave, they might want to chat with you.
Sure.
Okay? Thank you.
No report, Mayor. Thank you.
Okay. No city administrator's report. Let's move to department head information.
No further report this evening, Mayor.
No reports. Okay. In our packets, we have the police department, the 10th period report. But since Chief Thomas is so new, we're not going to make him go through that on there.
Birth by fire. Yes, we are.
He's been here for an hour and 15 minutes. Let's go. Come on.
Let's go.
So.
If there are questions, though, please send those on. We'll get back to the audience.
Yes, that is good. So if anyone has any questions on council on that report, please get them to Brian so he can get them to the chief. Let's move to the treasurer's report. Who is going to, Paul, are you going to do the treasurer's report?
Okay. Warrant number 151614. We have general fund expenditures $226,667.83. Water fund expenditures $280,824.95. Motor fuel tax fund expenditures $75,093.25. Capital improvement fund expenditures $143,770.52. Federal equitable sharing fund expenditures $35,685.94. With a subtotal of $762,042.49. We have payroll for 10/29/15 in the amount of $279,160.71 for a total to be approved by City Council of $1,041,203.20.
Okay. Do I have a motion to approve? Alderman Schauer, seconded by Alderman Marquez. Any questions for Paul? I think we addressed him in the work session. The roll, please.
Schauer.
Aye.
Marquez.
Aye.
Belke.
Aye.
Kenny.
Aye.
Belzac.
Aye.
MacIver.
Aye.
Six ayes and one absent.
The warrant has been approved. Let's move to standing committee reports. Alderman Marquez.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Just a reminder, the Municipal Services Committee meets next Monday, November 23rd at 6:30 here in the Council Chambers.
Alderman MacIver.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. At this evening's police committee meeting, we welcome the new chief, or interim chief. We also approve the minutes from the September 21st, 2015 police committee meeting. And we have a meeting scheduled for Monday, the 21st of December at 6 p.m. in the police department training room, pending agenda items.
Thank you. Alderman Schauer.
Thank you, Madam Mayor. Our next admin finance meeting will be held on Monday, December 7th at 6 p.m. in our upstairs meeting room.
Okay. To be followed by photos. Okay. Let's move to questions, comments, agenda related from anyone in the council. I think we addressed most everything. Does anyone in the audience want to address the council on any items that were on the agenda this evening? Okay, then let's move to old business, and there being no old business, I'll move right to consent agenda. The two items on the consent agenda this evening are both motions to grant waivers of raffle license bonds. One, the first one is for the Darien Historical Society, and the second one is for the Darien Women's Club. Do I have a motion to approve? Alderman MacIver, seconded by Alderman Kenny. The roll, please.
MacIver?
Aye.
Kenny?
Aye.
Belke?
Aye.
Belzac?
Aye.
Marquez?
Aye.
Shower?
Aye.
Six ayes.
Both items have been approved. There are no items on new business this evening, so I'll just move to questions, comments, and announcements of a general nature. Do any of the aldermen have announcements to make?
And Mayor, I think we should congratulate the Hinsdale South football team. They're moving right on. I was at the game Saturday night while you guys were dancing. What a great game! And they're 13th seed, and they're just climbing.
They beat a higher rated rival.
Yeah, Lincoln Way North was undefeated, and it was their Lincoln Way North's last game because they're
closing
the school.
That campus. Yeah. Yes.
To piggyback off of that, I want to congratulate the Hinsdale South cross-country team. They came in fourth for the state, the highest ranking they've ever gotten.
And your son just happens to be a member of that,
happens
doesn't he?
To be a member on it, exactly.
Congratulations. we got to bring the cross-country team in.
We should.
Yeah. Yeah. You know how much we love to have the kids come in. We should do that. Okay. All right. Is there anyone in the audience want to address the city council? Then I would like to ask for a motion to adjourn. Alderman MacIver, seconded by Alderman Belke. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Thank you. I don't know how
turning the microphones off.
I don't know if we could have handled that any better. I think that group was.